A major part of Pye's business was built on radio technology. Radio is a huge part of our lives today. Mobile phones, television, Wi-Fi all use radio, but how does radio work? This video attempts to explain. Radio waves are a type of electromagnetic radiation. The diagram shows the different types of electromagnetic radiation and its uses as the frequency increases and the corresponding wavelength reduces. As the frequency increases, then electromagnetic waves have different properties and uses as indicated. In this video, we will be talking about radio waves used for broadcast radio and television, where the wavelength is typically between 30 centimeters and 1500 meters long. Radio waves are radiated by electrons when they are accelerated, which means changing their speed or direction. Electrons are very small particles that have a negative charge of electricity, and they normally travel around the nucleus of an atom. They're far too small to be seen, but their presence can be felt everywhere. An electric current occurs when electrons move from atom to atom in an electric circuit. This happens each time you switch on an electric light, for example. In order to create radio waves, you first need a specially shaped metal conductor called an antenna or aerial. A radio transmitter is then connected to the antenna, and this applies a voltage to it. The voltage oscillates, which means it varies regularly as shown. This causes an oscillating electric current to flow in the antenna as the electrons move back and forth. The movement of the electrons back and forth then causes radio waves to be emitted from the antenna. This animation represents the radio waves being transmitted from the antenna, although they can't actually be seen in practice. Radio waves are also called electromagnetic waves because they are made up of both electric and magnetic components. The electric component E is shown in blue in the diagram, and the magnetic component B is shown in red. The waves are radiated from the antenna at the speed of light, which is 300 million meters per second, or 186,000 miles per second. If you place another antenna attached to a radio receiver at a distance from the transmitter, then when the radio waves strike the receiving antenna, they push the electrons in the metal back and forth, creating small oscillating currents which are detected by the receiver. The frequency is how often the waves oscillate back and forth and is measured in hertz or cycles per second. The wavelength is the distance between each peak as the waves pass through space. It's equal to the speed of light divided by the frequency. So how do you send a signal or other information using radio waves? Well, the information that you wish to send is first converted into an electrical signal. The information could be sound, a picture, or digital information, etc. If the information to be sent is a sound, then a microphone, as shown in the picture, is used to convert the sound waves into an electrical signal that represents the sound. Sound waves hit a diaphragm in the microphone that vibrates, moving a magnet near a coil, and this creates a small electric current that represents the sound. This electrical signal is used to modulate, which means modify or vary, the radio wave, called the carrier, that is transmitted. Early radios used amplitude modulation, AM, where the amplitude, the signal strength of the carrier wave, is varied in proportion to that of the voice signal being transmitted. The diagram shows the appearance of an amplitude modulated high frequency carrier wave. And for simplicity, the voice signal shown here is a simple sine wave, but in actual fact the voice signal would actually be more complex. The frequency of the carrier wave is constant and is chosen to be a different frequency for each radio station. The modulated signal is amplified or made larger by the transmitter, which is connected to the transmitting antenna. The modulated signal is then radiated from the antenna as a radio wave. The radio signal from the transmitter is received by the radio receiver's antenna, where the original sound from the studio is extracted so that it can be heard by the listener. So how does the radio receiver do this? The rest of this video will explain. The radio shown here is a Pye 25C valve portable radio from 1929, which can be seen in the museum. The BBC had begun broadcasting in 1922, and radio had become very popular for home entertainment in the days long before television and the internet. The picture on the right shows the radio viewed from the back and open to reveal the electronics. The radio would have had an accumulator to power the valve heaters and a high voltage battery to power the rest of the set, and these would have been housed in the compartment at the bottom of the cabinet. An accumulator is a rechargeable low voltage battery similar to a small car battery, and people used to take them to their local radio or bicycle shop to get them recharged. The antenna was a coiled wire on a frame mounted in the back of the set and was connected to the rest of the receiver by wires. Since several radio stations may be received at the antenna at the same time, a tuned circuit is used in the radio receiver to select the wanted carrier frequency and to reject the unwanted frequencies. A tuned circuit consists of two electronic components, a coil and a capacitor. When the tuning control on the side of the set is turned, it moves the interleaved plates on the tuning capacitor as shown. This changes the frequency that the tuned circuit selects so that it passes some frequencies to the rest of the radio and rejects others. The selected radio signal is then passed to the radio frequency receiving valves, where it's made larger than the very small signal received at the antenna. It consists of the carrier signal that's been modulated with the audio signal. The radio now needs to extract the modulated signal from the carrier wave, and the way it does this is to use a rectifier. A rectifier is an electrical device that converts an alternating signal, which periodically reverses direction, to a signal that only passes in one direction. When the modulated carrier wave is passed through the rectifier, then the rectified signal now looks like the picture shown. The positive cycles of the carrier are passed on, but the negative parts of the signal are removed. This rectified signal is then filtered to remove the carrier frequency. This then leaves the audio signal that was originally modulated onto the carrier at the transmitter. The process of rectification and filtering is called detection. The detected audio signal is still too small to operate a loudspeaker, so it is then amplified by the audio amplifier valve. The audio signal is then amplified again by the audio output valve until the signal is large enough to power the loudspeaker, part of which can be seen at the bottom of the picture. The loudspeaker converts the audio output signal back into sound so that it can be heard by the listener. The loudspeaker works in the opposite way to a microphone. The audio output signal is passed through a coil near a magnet. The coil is connected to a paper cone, and as the audio current that represents the sound passes through the coil, it moves the loudspeaker cone, which creates sound waves in the air which the listener can hear. To learn more about the radios and other technologies that Pye produced from 1896 to 1970, please visit Cambridge Museum of Technology.